Hi, I'm Michael Brim. On behalf of our executive producer, Keith Payson, welcome to Panama City, Florida, and our film project, Ascensio, which is Latin for ascent. This video has three objectives, which are, first, to provide visual images of the locations used by the writer. Second, to offer producers physical and geographic options for filming. And third, to highlight some components of the story. The locations are presented in the order that they appear in the script. So welcome to Ascensio and Panama City, Florida. But first, we need to take a moment to mention a person of interest. Our story's antagonist is Harrison Van Gilder, a genetically enhanced serial killer. Born in 1763, Harrison has become a master predator, murdering out of necessity and for pleasure. The inciting incident of Ascensio has a setup and payoff. The setup is the discovery of the corpse of a 1,000-year-old Viking priest by anthropologist Stephen Atticus. The payoff comes when Harrison, during his global peregrinations, strolls into Panama City, Florida. Harrison will charm, lie, manipulate, and play games to reach his three goals. Those goals are blood, lust, and fame. Now, with Harrison in town, the coastal community of Panama City, Florida is under assault by a serial killer. A killer like no other. Now, welcome to Panama City, just a short day's drive south of Atlanta, a hub of the film industry. Producing pictures in Panama City can be a pleasure, where life sets sail.
I understand that at the time of the murder you were walking along the beach. Run into anyone on this relaxing stroll?
After his arrival in Panama City, Harrison's first priority was to create a resting place. A graveyard like Oak Grove Cemetery was always a good refuge, and the cemetery closed at dusk, another good thing. The cemetery is surrounded by an old brick wall, an ancient barrier 10 feet high, much of it covered in ivy and other growth. To create his secret abode, one night after the burial of an old man, Harrison dug up the grave, hid the corpse temporarily in a tree, and excavated a spacious underground chamber. In the center was the old man's coffin. Harrison also created an escape route beneath the cemetery wall. Later in our story, Harrison, in his resting place, is discovered by authorities at midnight. Enraged, he drags his kidnapped and nude victim, Susan Shuang, out of the chamber, through the underground escape route and across the railroad tracks. Through a hole in the chain link fence, Harrison crosses the maintenance yard and breaks into the public works building. Ultimately, surrounded by police, he abandons his victim. Naked, he leaps through a panel of glass windows. Shots are fired as he races across the maintenance yard. Harrison makes his escape by leaping the railroad tracks in front of a roaring locomotive and its long train of cars. This is the end of Act One. Fictional Harbor Avenue is the center of Panama City, and on that street is the Friendly Flagon, a quaint historic watering hole. There are at least three buildings that can serve as filming locations for the Flagon. The first is a former bookstore. It has an open interior that could be converted into a pub. The second is a functioning retail space available for temporary rent with a classic arcade building. In addition, the back of the building serves as the Maxwell Hotel. The third Flagon option is actually two spaces within a New Orleans-style building. The first is the old Marie Beauty store. The second, on the corner, is the Royale Lounge. This lounge would be our recommendation for the setting of the Friendly Flagon. The fictional White Sands Hotel, the Sheraton on Grand Lagoon, is Harrison's choice for a night out. Our Florida film commissioner can arrange for filming within and outside the hotel. We also recommend the Sheraton for lodging of our director and principal film producers. The porte cochere is an important landmark in our story. This is the Tides Lounge, where Harrison meets his first victim, Elizabeth Parker, and her friend, Lori Benton. A cameo with Harry Connick Jr. at the piano would be a nice southern touch. Harrison hunts at night. One evening, while imbibing in the Friendly Flagon, he orders transportation to a more upscale night spot and a better hunting ground. Joseph Davis, a driver for luxury limousines, picks him up and takes him to the White Sands Hotel. After dropping Harrison off within the porte cochere, Joseph parks and waits. During that time, Harrison mesmerizes and manipulates Elizabeth and leaves Lori behind, stunned and confused. Joseph takes Harrison and his prey to Caraco Bayou. Caraco Bayou, Pathway to Murder. In the middle of the night, Joseph drops Harrison and Elizabeth off at a small municipal park on the shores of a quiet embayment, Caraco Bayou. Van Gilder coaxes his victim along a shoreline path to a spot for seduction and murder. The following afternoon, Carrico Bayou is a frantic crime scene. Lieutenant John Willoughby is in charge. With him is Coroner David Booth. And nipping at Willoughby's heels is the pesky and persistent reporter, Al Keeling. At the end of the path is the victim, Elizabeth, drained of her blood that is not present anywhere at the crime scene. Beneath her head is a letter written by an executed and dead serial killer. Channel 8 TV Studios. Channel 8 News is the pipeline of instantaneous information for the citizens of Panama City, and the chief news anchor is the award-winning Bob Jensen. We can use the news studio in the middle of the night for filming, and the real local news anchor, Jerry Brown of Channel 13 News, has read the script, likes it, and has offered to play the role of our fictitious news anchor, Bob Jensen. Franklin Center Post Office. At night, at the Franklin Center Post Office, Harrison waits with Joseph, who has been abducted with his limousine. Harrison watches for the mayor's would-be daughter-in-law, Susan Shuang, to enter the building and get mail. Harrison slips a knife into Joseph's side and gets out of the limo, and then kidnaps the girl. As he heads for his graveyard asylum, police with police dogs pursue. Stripping off the girl's clothes and his, he secures them in his looped belt. To divert the dogs in dense fog, he stops an old woman in a car, terrifies her, and then slips the loop of clothing around her bumper just as she drives away. Then, through a manhole leading to the sewer, he drags the girl in the opposite direction toward his hideaway. The Van Gilder House. Harrison is the psychopathic cunning rogue of the Van Gilder family. His brother Edward, with his mate Helen and their son Bradley, are predators who blend in to the human population. They live here quietly in the Van Gilder House. This home is owned by Mr. Coleman Smith. I have visited the home with my storyboard artist son, Chris. It can be rented, has a fascinating interior, and is very near the Sheraton Resort. City Hall and Federal Courthouse. Welcome to City Hall, where Mayor Larry Hayes sees after the needs of Panama City. It is here where, after the murders begin, the mayor's law enforcement science task force holds critical, sometimes frantic meetings. In the second script, Harrison is captured and tried in federal court. Among the charges are kidnapping and murder. Oaks by the Bay Park. The park at the southern terminus of Beck Avenue is a serene area in the St. Andrews section of Panama City. It is shaded with venerable live oaks and is a short, pleasant walk from South Home, the Atticus rental house. The deck on the bay, with its sandy beach, is an optional location for a scene coming up at Barefoot on the Bay, where Atticus and Van Leeuwen are conversing as Susan meets Bradley Van Gilder walking his dog on the shoreline. the St. Andrews section of Panama City. St. Andrews is an artist, musician, vendor, and fishing community with a marina and a museum. It has small restaurants and cafes that are involved throughout the trilogy. It is at one of these, a coffee bistro cafe, that Lieutenant Willoughby, while having breakfast, receives the call from Harrison proposing the climactic midnight rendezvous out at the remote Shell Island Lake. Barefoot on the Bay Restaurant. Barefoot on the Bay is a nice, pleasant deck at the end of the huge shrimp boat restaurant, which overlooks the marina and bay. It is here where Atticus and Van Leeuwen discuss the former's arranged sabbatical and watch Susan encounter Bradley Van Gilder and his dog, a black lab named Smokey. South Home, the Atticus Rental House. South Home is where Stephen and Barbara Atticus live, along with Susan Stratford and the elderly Dutch zoologist, Bank Van Leeuwen. Several scenes take place in the house, on the spacious covered porch, and, in script 2, at the exterior rear of the home where Harrison murders Al Keeling. South Home, a name given the house by Dr. Van Leeuwen, provides a bit of quiet, deep south imagery. It is also where Susan Stratford experiences the completion of her genetic transformation into a predator, the result of a viral transfer when Robert Van Gilder, Harrison's younger brother, seduced and assaulted her at the scientific conference in Massachusetts 100 days earlier. Yancey Park and the Friday the 13th Murder. The hideous murder of the Red Lady of Yancey Park takes place here. It is Harrison's last slaughter before the climax, a disemboweled transvestite hung by his legs, spread-eagled from a huge horizontal limb of an oak tree. It is early February on Valentine's Day, and Peter the Wino Martin wakes up from a bench where he has been sleeping. Staggering to the fountain, he splashes water to wake himself, his thoughts on the homeless food kitchen a block away. But as he looks up, he sees the Red Lady of Yancey Park, has a terrible personal flashback in his mind, and flips out. Within minutes, the park is a huge crime scene. The Maxwell Hotel. Watching the police work, two people peek out of a window of the Maxwell Hotel. They are Harrison and his new mate, Ingrid DeVore. They are in the real crime scene, a shabby apartment in the Flophouse Hotel. The apartment is the setting for the beginning of the second script. A small cafe in St. Andrews. It is in this small St. Andrews cafe that Willoughby is eating an early breakfast the day after the Red Lady murder. He is interrupted by a call on the cafe phone. It is Harrison proposing a midnight rendezvous. After the call, the angry lieutenant phones FBI agent Mark Pierce. The Midnight Rendezvous at a Shell Island Lake. This is the climax scene and Harrison's biggest con job to date. As the Marine Patrol surrounds the west end of the island, Willoughby, Pierce, and two officers discover a gun-firing crazed lunatic, a headless corpse on a raft in the lake, and a deep-sea fishing rig owned by Willoughby himself. The scene is on Florida State Park lands, and a permit can be obtained to film here. The scene is at midnight. Equipment and crews can be transported by 24-foot patio boats from the Sheraton Hotel Bay Point Marina on Grand Lagoon to the access beach 3 miles away. Then, beach patrol vehicles can be used to transport equipment and crew 1 mile down the beach to the scene location. In conclusion, on-location filming in Panama City has some advantages. Our production company has myriad business connections, including Film Commissioner Julie Gordon. Through Ms. Gordon, we can gain economical lodging and catering, expedient issuance of film permits, and access to experienced local actors. Also, major studio film crews and equipment can be transported by vehicle from Atlanta in 1 day. Finally, air connections include nonstop flights to Atlanta, Houston, and Baltimore, and United flights from Panama City to Los Angeles with 1 stop in Houston. We hope this video has provided some valuable information regarding Panama City filming.
Still down.